Ashet Audio presents The Drop, written by Michael Connelly, read by Len Cariou.
Chapter 1. Christmas came once a month in the open unsolved unit. That was when the lieutenant made her way around the squad room like Santa Claus, parceling out the assignments like presents to the squad's six detective teams. The cold hits were the lifeblood of the unit. The teams didn't wait for call-outs and fresh kills in open unsolved. They waited for cold hits. The open unsolved unit investigated unsolved murders going back 50 years in Los Angeles. There were 12 detectives, a secretary, a squad room supervisor known as the whip, and the lieutenant. And there were 10,000 cases. The first five detective teams split up the 50 years, each pair taking 10 randomly chosen years. Their task was to pull all the unsolved homicide cases from their assigned years out of the archives, evaluate them, and submit long-stored and forgotten evidence for reanalysis with contemporary technology. All DNA submissions were handled by the new regional lab out at Cal State. When DNA from an old case was matched to an individual whose genetic profile was carried in any of the nation's DNA databases, it was called a cold hit. The lab put cold hit notices in the mail at the end of every month. They would arrive a day or two later at the police administration building in downtown Los Angeles. Usually by 8 a.m. that day, the lieutenant would open the door of her private office and enter the squad room. She carried the envelopes in her hand. Each hit sheet was mailed individually in a yellow business envelope. Generally, the envelopes were handed to the same detectives who had submitted the DNA evidence to the lab. But sometimes there were too many cold hits for one team to handle at once. Sometimes detectives were in court or on vacation or leave, and sometimes the cold hits revealed circumstances that required the utmost finesse and experience. That was where the sixth team came in. Detectives Harry Bosch and David Chu were the sixth team. They were floaters. They handled overflow cases and special investigations. On Monday morning, October 3rd, Lieutenant Gail Duvall stepped out of her office and into the squad room, carrying only three yellow envelopes. Harry Bosch almost sighed at the sight of such a paltry return on the squad's DNA submissions. He knew that with so few envelopes, he would not be getting a new case to work. Bosch had been back in the unit for almost a year following a two-year reassignment to Homicide Special. But coming back for his second tour of duty in Open Unsolved, he had quickly fallen into the rhythm of the squad. It wasn't a fly squad. There was no dashing out the door to get to a crime scene. In fact, there were no crime scenes. There were only files and archive boxes. It was primarily an 8-to-4 gig with an asterisk, that asterisk being that there was more travel than with other detective squads. People who got away with murder, or at least thought they had, tended not to stick around. They moved elsewhere, and often the OU detectives had to travel to retrieve them. A big part of the rhythm was the monthly cycle of waiting for the yellow envelopes to come out. Sometimes Bosch found it hard to sleep during the nights leading up to Christmas. He never took time off during the first week of the month and never came to work late if there was a chance that the yellow envelopes were in. Even his teenage daughter noticed his monthly cycle of anticipation and agitation and had likened it to a menstrual cycle. Bosch didn't see the humor in this and was embarrassed when she brought it up. Now his disappointment at the sight of so few envelopes in the lieutenant's hand was something palpable in his throat. He wanted a new case. He needed a new case. He needed to see the look on the killer's face when he knocked on the door and showed his badge, the embodiment of unexpected justice come calling after so many years. It was addictive, and Bosch was craving it now. The lieutenant handed the first envelope to Rick Jackson. He and his partner, Rich Bengston, were solid investigators who had been with the unit since its inception. Bosch had no complaint there. The next envelope was placed on an empty desk belonging to Teddy Baker. She and her partner, Greg Keough, were on their way back from a pickup in Tampa, Florida. An airline pilot who had been connected through fingerprints to the 1991 strangulation of a flight attendant in Brentwood. Bosch was about to suggest to the lieutenant that Baker and Keough might have their hands full with the Brentwood case, and that the envelope should be given to another team, namely his, when the lieutenant looked at him and used the last remaining envelope to beckon him to her office. "Can you guys step in for a minute? You too, Tim?" Tim Marcia was the squad whip, the detective three who handled mostly supervisory and fill-in duties in the squad. He mentored the young detectives and made sure the old ones, like Jackson and Bosch, didn't get lazy. Bosch was up out of his seat before the lieutenant had finished her question. He headed toward the lieutenant's office with Chu and Marcia trailing behind. "Close the door," Duval said. "Sit down." Duval had a corner office with windows that looked across Spring Street at the Los Angeles Times building. Paranoid that reporters were watching from the newsroom across the way, Duval kept her blinds permanently closed. It made the office dim and cave-like. Bosch and Chu took the two seats positioned in front of the lieutenant's desk. Marcia followed them in, moved to the side of Duval's desk, and leaned against an old evidence safe. "I want you two to handle this hit," she said, proffering the yellow envelope to Bosch. "There's something wrong there, and I want you to keep quiet about it until you find out what it is. Keep Tim in the loop, but keep it low-key." The envelope had already been opened. Chu leaned over to look as Harry opened the flap and pulled out the hit sheet. It listed the case number for which DNA evidence had been submitted, plus the name, age, last known address, and criminal history of the person whose genetic profile matched it. Bosch first noticed that the case number had an 89 prefix, meaning it was a case from 1989. There were no details about the crime, just the year. But Bosch knew that 1989 cases belonged to the team of Ross Schuler and Adriana Dolan. He knew this because 1989 had been a busy year for him, working murders for the homicide special team, and he had recently checked on one of his own unsolved cases, learning that jurisdiction over cases from that year belonged to Schuler and Dolan. They were known in the unit as the Kids. They were young, passionate, and very skillful investigators, but between them, they had less than 8 years' experience working homicides. If there was something unusual about this cold hit, it would not be surprising that the lieutenant would want Bosch on it. Bosch had worked more killings than everybody in the unit combined. That is, if you took out Jackson. He had been around forever. Bosch next studied the name on the hit sheet. Clayton S. Pell. It meant nothing to him. But Pell's record included numerous arrests and three separate convictions for indecent exposure, false imprisonment, and forcible rape. He had spent 6 years in prison for the rape before being released 18 months earlier. He had a 5-year probation tail, and his last known address came from the State Probation and Parole Board. He was living at a halfway house for sexual offenders in Panorama City. Based on Pell's record, Bosch believed the 1989 case was likely a sex-related murder. He could feel his insides beginning to tighten. He was going to go out and grab Clayton Pell and bring him to justice.
"Do you see it?"
Duval asked. "See what?" Bosch asked. "Was this a sex killing? This guy has the classic predator."
"The birth date,"
Duval said. Bosch looked back down at the hit sheet as Chu leaned over further. "Yeah, right here," Bosch said. "November 9, 1981. What's that got?"
"He's too young," Chu said.
Bosch glanced at him and then back down at the sheet.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.